Hello, I'm Courtney Holland. Welcome to Save Our Towns, a series designed to guide and inspire those who are working hard in Appalachia to build strong communities. The episodes, created by Outreach and International Affairs at Virginia Tech, celebrate what is great about small towns and connect you with experts, resources, and more. In this episode, you'll learn why they love sunny days in Bedford, Virginia. Then it's over to Marion for an update, up into the sky for small town big number, and down to earth for a provocative expert tip. As always, we close with three questions for our mayor. First, your example of awesome story. The educational website Solar Power Rocks recently gave Virginia a C on its 2018 Solar Report Card. Though the Commonwealth may be just average, the town of Bedford is an A++ by any standard. Andrea Brunet reports.
Bedford is known for its carefully preserved central business district, including this 19th century meeting house, and a National D-Day memorial. But these days, the town is making modern history with a different sort of property. It is the first Virginia town to have devoted public land to a solar farm, which helps produce electricity for almost 6,000 residential customers, plus about 900 commercial and industrial users. Town officials spent 2 years choosing a firm to lease the land and develop the farm, which opened at the end of 2017.
It's really cool to watch through the days of building to where it's from scratch to now. When we came out here, it was an empty field.
The company supplies solar power to the town at market prices.
It wasn't a big risk for us because we were able to implement terms in our purchase power agreement that we think mitigate any risk that we might have over the life of the project.
Power is fed into the town's existing grid, supplying enough juice to power about 500 homes annually. The farm has more than 10,000 panels that move, tracking the sun. But Bedford Solar Farm does more than just generate thousands of megawatt hours annually. The farm also generates renewable energy certificates, which can then be sold to companies that want the credits.
They find in the marketplace that they are selling that this is a desirable trait that they want to pass on to their customers. And they're willing to work with their supplier in order to assure their market that they are using renewable energy in the production of their products.
15% to 20% of the town's energy currently comes from renewables. The town also has a hydroelectric plant, and it produces a higher percentage of the town's renewable energy. But certificates from the solar farm are more valuable.
Solar facilities have achieved a carve-out in renewable energy portfolios that makes it more valuable because it's a newer technology.
An added benefit of the solar farm, it put 20 acres near a former landfill to good use. These big fellows are also put to good use maintaining the grounds. The company, O2EMC, touts all the green benefits, including these equivalents. To generate this much power the old way, 1.3 million gallons of water, or 7.6 million pounds of coal, would be consumed annually.
With energy production revolving around the solar farm, town leaders see nothing but blue skies ahead. And they're not at all sheepish about making that claim.
We found that we're meeting our expectations in terms of cost effectiveness. And in our initial calculations, we anticipate that it will remain that way as long as it continues to operate as efficiently as has been so far.
Now we turn to Marion, Virginia, the town we're following for a year. Diane Deffenbaugh reports.
Marion, Virginia has seen a lot of success in revitalizing its downtown, but the town's Director of Economic Development, Ken Heath, isn't resting just yet.
Because I love for people to come in and say, okay, you've done this, but don't sit on your laurels. What's the next step?
This spring, the town is seeking to put its best foot forward in welcoming motorists whizzing by on nearby Interstate 81.
You know, you have a plat of land out here, 8 acres, that's right beside the interstate. That's a perfect location for a chain restaurant or a gas station or something to come in that gets people off the interstate. And then my job will be to get you from that point on into the downtown. And it's a short ride. It's an attractive ride. And that's a pretty easy goal for us to accomplish if we can just be all the pieces put together.
But all of those pieces are not yet in place. Town leaders must have a VDOT maintenance shed moved, and that requires legislation. In the meantime, the town plans to take a first step.
We have this Welcome to Marion sign that we have partnered with Virginia Tourism. That'll be a place you can have your picture made behind it that we're going to put up. That'll help draw the attention down from the razor wire. We're going to put up hopefully some dogwoods out through there and continue to enhance all we can.
Even that baby step can generate momentum.
We've always done here. You know, we may not be able to get dressed up in a tuxedo every day to come to work, but we can sure clean our shoes. And that's what we're doing, is doing the best we can with what we have and realizing that every small victory is a victory that leads to the bigger.
Next, pipeline projects cutting across Appalachia are generating court battles. Your Small Town Big Number segment takes a closer look, complete with views from October 2018 of the Mountain Valley Pipeline from the air.
Mountain Valley Pipeline construction runs through rivers, streams, wetlands, and national forests. Nearby landowners are hugely affected. Court interpretations of the Natural Gas Act have granted pipeline builders the right to use eminent domain. So today our number is 717, or to be more explicit, Chapter 717F parenthesis H of Title 15 of the U.S. Code Chapter 15B. That's a mouthful, but it's central when people lose title to their properties over pipelines. Federal law grants private companies the right to take someone's land, though it doesn't address the so-called quick take practice. Federal agencies can use quick take, but the law's provision doesn't apply to private companies. However, the courts have held that the same principle should apply in pipeline cases. Here's what happened with the Mountain Valley Pipeline. A federal district court issued injunctions against landowners. This allowed pipeline builders to start work immediately. The quick take happens even before the land's value has been assessed. So our number is 717, but when talking about rights granted to pipeline builders, you might more accurately say that landowners' rights have been given the deep six.
Now for your expert tip. Pipelines and other big projects come with promises of more jobs, but David Sly, Conservation Director of Wild Virginia, cautions that the money gained and lost doesn't always balance out in a town's favor.
Don't be fooled by the promises of economic gain. Just because somebody wants to bring a big operation into your locality. Now, I don't say that that's not a valid concern. I don't say that you can't gain some from those activities. But you really have to think about all the other effects. You know, a lot of people are in those areas because they feel like they're avoiding a lot of the threats that they would face somewhere else.
You can read a transcript of the complete interview at the Save Our Towns website, where Sly explains that when towns have the law on their side, they can sometimes win those David and Goliath fights. And now a reminder about Virginia Cooperative Extension. Extension agents and specialists live and work around the Commonwealth, dedicated to subjects such as land management, livestock quality, youth development, and community leadership.
On the Save Our Towns website, click on the Extension tab. There you can learn much more. You'll find extension agents listed along with their areas of expertise and contact information.
Now it's back to Bedford for three questions for a mayor.
Okay, Robert T. Wandry, town of Bedford, and I'm the mayor. I would say very friendly. The biggest challenge is the renovation of the Bedford Middle School, which was recently closed when they built the new middle school out at 122. There are four buildings on this property. It's a question of getting the most use out of each of these four buildings and in such a way that it would be fit well with the neighborhood. The thing about it is, what are you going to do to put in a formal school building? We are looking at a number of possibilities, and right now we're in the midst of making that decision. Well, it's the home of the National D-Day Memorial. Of course, we're a very patriotic community. We honor our veterans. Recently, we had a group of people come in from France, Normandy, because that's where the D-Day invasion took place. And of course, the Bedford National Guard was one of the first units to land on Normandy. We lost 19 individuals on D-Day, and that was percentage-wise the highest number of any community in the United States.
Would you like to nominate your town for an Examples of Awesome story? We'd love to hear from you. To view past episodes and to dive deeper into resources and a wealth of information about small towns, go to the Save Our Towns website. And please send your thoughts to saveourtowns@vt.edu. We read and respond to every email. This is episode 4 of season 5. Thanks for watching.